Loveline, coast to coast.
Yeah. Hey, I forgot how to do this. It's Loveline. I'm Adam Carolla. It's Dr. Drew over there. Phone number 1-800-LOVE-191. Fax number 310-854-4455. Dr. Drew is a board-certified physician and a little bit of an addiction medicine specialist. And speaking of addiction, Jay, let's talk a little about booze and the new year. I did a little heaving Monday morning.
Imagine that.
Yeah. And you know what's weird? I've changed my vomit schedule as it pertains to booze.
It goes later in the morning?
Well, I used to heave before I went to bed.
Right.
Now I get a miserable night's sleep and heave in the morning. Mm. That's my new schedule. I'm working into paying someone to heave for me. I don't know if those people are out there. Perhaps a day laborer I could pick up to heave
for
me.
They won't show up on time either. Not that the day laborers wouldn't, but with your luck with the garbage man and the mailman and all that.
I want to talk about this whole hangover thing because, I was dying to ask you because we've talked about this before.
You were too busy abusing me.
I had to abuse Drew when he came over because Drew was full of S. And Drew, I had a New Year's Eve party, which I have to talk about. And I had abused Drew that. That's how that pertains to that. But I want to talk about being hungover because you're a doctor. And every year at this time of year, before New Year's Eve, all the news stations run these tips for hangovers and hangover remedies. And they interview these guys. And there's guys who've written books. None of them are doctors.
It's nonsense.
They're just idiots. But they tell you what to do. Yeah. And let me tell you something. Most of them end with drink in moderation. And to me, that's not a tip.
Right.
Like, if I'm going to offer tips on how to travel cheaply and say, stay home.
Right. Or don't how to survive a high-speed accident. Don't get in your car.
Don't get in your car. Yeah. That ain't a goddamn tip. Yeah. You telling me to drink in moderation is not a hangover tip.
Right.
That I can figure out.
Yes.
As a matter of fact, every day I don't drink, I'm not hungover.
It sort of proves the fact that you really can't do much with the hangover, doesn't it? Because if they really can fix the hangover,
why give you all the other tips and then at the end of the whole session say, don't drink too much?
Yeah, you know, the New England Journal ran a big article about hangover, and the only thing I took home from that article was that what we used to call hangover was largely alcohol withdrawal, and they're kind of rethinking that. There's some other aspects of hangover, but in terms of treatment,
nothing. Okay, so here's one thing they do agree on. Hydration.
Yes.
You've got to hydrate yourself. You got to drink lots of water.
When you're vomiting, though.
Well, see, my problem is I try to chug the water 10 seconds before I'm vomiting.
Nice.
And that's just more that comes out. I got to hydrate while I'm drinking.
Water,
I think that's the problem.
You.
Well, it doesn't hurt.
It could.
Oh, yeah, I guess it does. Well, no, wait a minute. Now, hold on. Okay, so here's the first tip I get from the guy on Channel 7 two days before. He says you must be very well hydrated.
Yes.
Here is what you do, he says. Take your body weight. Okay, I'm 190 pounds. Cut it in half. Okay, that's 95 pounds. And drink that many ounces of water before you leave the house.
95 ounces?
Yeah, so I'm going to chug 3/4 of a gallon of water before I leave the house. That's a number one worthless tip, because these tips they give you that cannot be done, that ain't a tip.
Yeah.
Do you know what I'm saying?
Right.
You want to get in shape? Do 700 push-ups every morning and walk on your hands to the mailbox.
Yeah.
That'll strengthen your upper body. Yeah, I guess it would, except for it cannot be done.
Right.
Drink half of your body weight in ounces in water. Recalculus.
And by the way, in water or in fluid?
Water.
Oh, boy.
They always speak in terms of water.
Yeah.
Okay, so drink that in water. Well, anyone knows. Anyone, if you get yourself a tumbler, a 16-ounce tumbler, fill it to the top, drink it, and then fill it to the top again and drink it. Now you're 32 ounces. Halfway into your third tumbler of 16 ounces, you're heaving.
Mm-hmm.
Jesus Christ. And that ain't even halfway to my 95 ounces of water.
Mm-hmm.
So I want to punch that guy. That's the same a-hole who said don't drink too much. More worthless tips. Hydrate. Drink, eat vitamin B.
Yeah.
That's one you said. And I'm hip to that.
Yeah, the B vitamins are good.
But here's what's going on with me, Drew. I didn't even drink that much. And I did. Well, actually, I didn't drink. You know, they tell you to drink a glass of water. Here's the whole problem with the whole drinking and moderation and the whole hangover thing. You're drunk. See, you're not worried about, I mean, you're up on the roof trying to do a cannonball into the pool. You're not worried about having a glass of tap water in between shots of tequila.
Right.
You're S-faced, right. And that's why you're not heeding any of these warnings.
Right.
It's the same problem with driving drunk. It's like, hey, sounds great now, and then you get drunk,
yeah.
And your decision-making isn't what it could be.
Yep, that's right.
So the hydration thing I can't figure out. All I know is I heave the next morning, and I can't figure it out because I went to bed and felt fine. Now, what has changed in me, Drew? Do you know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
Why is it back in the day I would drink, if I drank too much, I would lie down in bed, the room would start spinning around, I'd get up and heave, and I'd go back to bed, I'd feel fine. I did that for the first 15 years of my life. Now, I go to bed, feel fine, wake up in the morning and heave.
Yeah, when you were three and used to do that?
Yeah.
The first 15 years?
No, I mean...
when you were 3 years old and used to...
Listen, Jack Hole, the first 15 years of my drinking career.
I see. Well, you're a little older. Did you take any aspirin or anything like that?
No, Motrin? I did not take the aspirin or the Motrin to upset the stomach. I did wake up with a headache and try to chug some water and hydrate myself, and that may have got my stomach, you know, got a little something in there.
Had you been drinking all day?
No, not all day, just all night, but not a ton. Mixing a lot of booze, and that's the other one you hear about.
Yeah.
Some people say it doesn't matter. Other people say it does matter.
I'm just thinking you may have had some gastritis, which is an inflammation of the lining of the stomach, and that can cause vomiting. You also can get alcohol withdrawal-related vomiting.
Huh.
And if you had been drinking for a few days in a row...
No. And what about last night? I woke up at 4 in the morning covered with sweat.
Oh, that's alcohol withdrawal.
Oh, really?
Oh, yes.
Really?
Oh, yes.
And there are pink elephants running around the room. I was chasing them with a butterfly net.
You've been drinking for a couple days. That's the deal here.
Covered with sweat.
Nice.
Covered.
I'm impressed.
Yeah, but I've done that before a few times for no reason. I do it periodically.
Yeah, some people do, but this is...
Really?
You might see if it, in some relationship to your alcohol consumption, perhaps. God knows, it's hard for you to tell.
I didn't really drink yesterday too much.
That's the point.
Yeah, but why... How dare you? How dare you make that assumption that I'm an alcoholic?
Now, speaking of how dare you, maybe the second hour, I want to hear the how dare you to your neighbors that you'd like to give.
I called Drew yesterday. I was PO'd about my neighbors who called the cops.
And one thing I want to give a how dare you on is we received a couple of letters of complaint about some rape call that we handled earlier in the month.
Never saw them.
Yeah, where one was intoxicated and people are alleging that we... somehow weren't familiar with the law that has it that you can't render consent when you're intoxicated, which is something we talk about every damn night. So I'm sorry.
Technically, through the eyes of California law, almost every sexual encounter I've ever had would be rape
in the court system. Ad nauseum. And I believe, if I remember that call right, we said, hey, you know, you're at a crossroads. You want to look at this as a victim. Remember this? This one
we've done 1,500 of these in the last week.
No, but this is the one where we went, okay, we're going to take a risk on this one and go, look, we're going to look at this at the crossroads. You're going to be a victim? You're going to make this a big deal? Or you're going to go forward and just put it out of here? And it was, we'll replay it again in a day or so and go on with our own commentary about it. So.
All right. Who sent you the letters?
Oh, I sent them to Ann.
Yeah, I never saw them. How come I never saw them?
So they just come in.
How? Is there a lot
But my basic, how dare you here is, hey, good people, know your enemies. Don't attack your allies, the people that are trying to help support your causes.
That's right.
And if we do say something that is unclear, help us clarify. But don't attack your allies and know your enemies.
Let me tell your enemies. The Japs and the Krauts.
Nice.
Those are the enemies. You understand me? Not us. We're American.
Nice.
Right, Drew? Is that what you're saying, Drew?
Yeah, that's what I'm saying.
Japs and the Krauts?
That's it, yeah.
That's right.
Hello?
Nick?
Yes.
You're 15. What's up?
Right before I have sex, you know, like, well, you know, the foreplay and everything, I can't seem to get, like, a full erection, like, solid hard, like, it's, you know, flimsy, and I seem to be pre-cumming a lot.
And when I
had to, like, force it in with my hand, and when I get going pretty good, it gets into a good erection.
Yeah.
But...
15. Oh, yeah. Boy.
But the thing is like, it's pre-cumming a lot.
Pre-coming a lot means you're dribbling?
Yes.
You got a horrible penis. That penis is a lemon. You got to send it back. That's bad news. I mean, at 15, you can't get a good boner, and you're pre-cumming all over. You're leaving a trail, of slime all the way to the bathroom.
Same partner?
I've been with about three, so. I mean, it's every single time I've done it, it does this.
Have you ever had a long-term girlfriend?
Yes, sir.
And it didn't work out? I mean, with the penis?
No, I mean, we did that routine for about a year. I mean,
you couldn't get into the groove?
No.
You're 15.
Jesus, this guy gets a lot of tail.
I mean, I got a decent size one. I mean, I'm 7 inches. I didn't think the size, I thought everything was the size. But then when you start getting into it, they say that's a major turnoff that they can't keep it straight.
All right, so you have a little difficulty. Your penis becomes leathery, as we used to say.
Yes, sir.
And it has a little difficulty. It's like trying to take a raw hot dog and shove it through the keyhole of a door or something. It bends and whatnot, and you have to kind of really guide it in there, right?
And why does the drip make any difference to him, and why is he aware of it? Why not wear a condom?
I wear a condom.
You wear a condom.
So how do you know you have pre-cum?
Because, like, when, you know, before playing, before you put it on.
Yeah, I mean, he pulls his underwear down, and it snaps back up to his crotch. Nick takes his underwear, pulls him down to his knees, and then there's that eep, whoosh, and his underwear snap right back up around his ass. It's like on a leash, like a surfboard.
Well,
okay, so
I think there's something up with his behavior.
No, what do you mean something up with his behavior? 14, he's got 15. That penis that dribbles. A lot of guys have
that.
Which
is normal.
That's normal. I don't, but that's normal.
Trouble gaining a full erection. I need to know if he's on any medication.
But when once he gets going and
he's
gets
okay.
The stimulation, and this is all kind of normal stuff.
Yeah, kind of.
Hey, Nick.
Nick, are you on any meds, medication?
No,
sir,
I'm not.
And Nick, once you do get it worked in and do get it going, then what happens?
Well, I go good from there. The longest I went is about 2-3 hours. I mean,
all
I
right.
Keep it going.
And,
all
right.
And
he's fine.
Do you have any medical problems?
Yeah, he's fine. He's fine. Let me tell you something.
Yeah.
You know what a penis is like for a 15-year-old guy? It's like a, I don't know, universal remote or a VCR or a new car. It's something you got to kind of figure out. You know what I mean?
Like, no, I think most guys, it just kind of, there it is.
No, but, there it is, but not with sex. Yeah. You got to kind of work with it a little bit. Break it in, figure out its tendencies.
I guess.
Get your confidence.
Yeah.
I mean, like, remember the first time you drove your car off the lot?
Yeah.
And you're driving down the street and you're thinking, geez, I'd like to move the seat back. And your hand was kind of flopping around on the side trying to figure out where it was. You were reaching where your old car seat was doing all that with the stereo and the wipers and everything. But 2 weeks into it, no problem.
It's that kind of thing.
A penis for a guy, a young guy, has got to kind of figure out the tendencies, what works, what doesn't work. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
I think that's all he needs to do.
I don't know.
7 inches, going for 2 hours, dribbling all the way to the bathroom.
15, he's not ready for all this.
No, please.
Really?
He put the condom on. Did you listen? Any guy who says that, no, sir, yes, ma'am, he can have sex at 15. Jessica?
Yes?
You're 13.
Mm-hmm.
What's up?
I think I'm attracted to my best friend.
You're gay.
I'm not gay.
Yes, you are. Listen to Drew.
Man. Okay, you know, it's kind of ironic that you say that because I'm, like, totally in love with Violent J.
Oh.
Violent J from our Violent J?
You are an asshole.
That Violent J?
Yeah.
Why is that ironic?
Because, you know, you're sitting there, I'm telling me I'm gay. You can't make that assumption because I'm...
Yeah, that was a tape-recorded voice drop-in. That was not me.
Oh, I was gonna...
You're fat. There,
whoa.
See? That was not me either.
Well, it was you. Hey, Jessica.
Yeah.
How old is your friend?
She's 16.
I understand what your question is. You're clear you're not gay.
Huh?
You're clear you're not gay.
I'm clear about
what is your question?
Clearly not gay, yes.
I'm totally sure I'm not gay.
What is your question, then?
I'm wondering why I'm attracted to her. I know for a fact I'm not gay.
Okay. Many people your age confuse intimate warm feelings with sexual feelings.
Chicks.
Well, no, guys do too, believe it or not.
Yeah, but not her age, really.
What? 13-year-old guys don't do that?
Not so much.
Not so much, I agree.
9, maybe.
Yeah.
Well, see, we've kissed before.
Ooh.
And,
You're gay.
I'm not.
Why, Drew, stop saying that. Why is this your best friend who's 3 grades above you? That's kind of weird, isn't it?
Well, I'm more mature than most girls my age.
I see, but she's in high school, and you're in the 6th, 7th grade?
8th.
You're in the 8th grade?
Yeah.
And she's in the 11th grade?
Yeah.
And she's hanging out with an 8th grader?
Yeah.
What's her problem?
No. She's just,
I know you're dynamite, baby, but what's her problem?
She doesn't have one. She's the best in the world.
Yeah. You're not answering the question, though.
What, does she not have friends her age?
No, actually, she does.
Uh-huh. And she kissed you.
Yeah.
So maybe she's a lesbo, too.
No, she's just very experimental.
All right. So what do you want? You want to have a relationship with her?
No.
All right. Well, then forget it.
What's your question?
Well, I'm curious if I should, reveal my feelings to her, tell her I'm attracted to her, or if I should...
She knows you are. You kissed her.
Jesus, you made out.
Well, we were kind of drunk then.
You pansy!
All right.
I'm not a pansy, Jay.
All right. Listen, Jessica.
Well, Jessica's scaring me.
Yeah, what's up with you? Where's your daddy?
Just paint me the picture of Jessica for a second. How much black?
Huh?
How much black what?
She's wearing.
Oh, are you? No, I'm not getting that vibe. You got black fingernail polish on?
No, but I got a dog collar on.
Uh oh.
See what I'm saying?
Uh oh. Where's daddy? What'd he do to you?
Oh, my daddy didn't do anything to me, but my best friend's daddy did.
Mm. Oh, now we're getting to it.
What happened?
He molested me and my best friend, but not the same one.
he molested his daughter and you?
Yeah.
Mm. And, how old were you?
Huh?
How old were you?
13.
Oh, this just recently?
Mm-hmm. In February.
What about before that?
I was molested by a chick in the bathroom when I was in elementary school.
That sounded more like it. How old was she?
She was a year older than me.
I see. So
that's where the older person people come from.
You got a lot of confusion, right?
Yeah.
And you're a little antisocial. I mean, no one admits that.
I'm not antisocial. I've got a lot of friends.
Yeah, but a lot of weirdo goth friends.
I got a little bit of...
A lot of screwballs that are also antisocial. You know, it's funny. Antisocial people like to congregate and talk about how much they hate other people.
Yeah.
I'm a true antisocial person, which is I sit alone.
And fly planes.
And talk about how much I hate people over the phone. Not with them in the same room. Hey, Jessica.
Yeah.
Listen, baby. You got bigger fish to fry than you being attracted to your best friend right now. You've been victimized a couple of times. You're 13, and you know what I know from doing this show? There's plenty of other opportunities for you to be victimized in the future.
Yeah.
Plenty. As a matter of fact, if I was a gambling man, which I am, Drew, get my wallet, I would bet that you're going to be molested, raped, or victimized in some other way multiple times.
If you don't break out of the cycle.
That's right.
It becomes a repetition compulsion. This whole thing now hanging around with older women because you're abused by older women.
Yes.
And, you're going to find, victimizers are going to find you.
Baby, you got to get some therapy. You got to talk to some counselor. You got to get it straight.
Okay.
You hear me? You know what I'm talking about.
Yeah. Can you say hi to Violent J real quick?
Yeah, although...
he may be listening.
What's her obsession with Violent J?
I know, but I think she believed he was here.
Oh, she's listening to last night's show with Violent J on it. I see.
The only weight I lift is my own, my big fat ass every day when I wake up. That was pretty good. My fat ass. Oh, my God. Hey, play that again.
Well, we did play it again.
Oh, man.
Eventually, I'd like to put an entire show together of just clever drops so that we don't have to come in.
Yeah.
Anderson just sits there and just pushes random buttons. Drew calls
it
people
fat. It could be like mixing songs.
Yeah. He'd be like a DJ spinning records. All right. Squeaks?
Yeah.
Is that your nickname, Squeaks?
Yeah.
You're 15. What's up?
I'm into, bondage.
Oh, boy.
And I want to know, because, a couple of my friends and, even my past boyfriends that have, done stuff with me told me that it's really bad and I have issues.
Yeah, you have issues? Yeah. Well, you do, don't you?
We get that just from the voice.
Okay, where's your dad? What'd he do to you?
I have a great dad. He's at home right now.
Do you have a great dad?
Yeah.
Did she say gay dad?
Right. I said great.
I see. And that's your real dad?
Yeah.
Your biological father?
I think so.
You sprung forth from his loins?
You think so? Are you kidding?
No. Well, okay, the thing is...
Uh-oh.
I'm like a real
mito
tera. I like go through my
parents'
stuff like a lot.
Hold on. Who was that?
She broke into Spanish for a second.
Yeah, it's like we were talking to Carmen Zapata for a second there. What happened, mijo?
Mija.
Mija? Yeah, mijo's a guy, right? Ho should be girl. They really got, you know, if I was president of Mexico, I'd say, look, we're taking the O that will be no longer feminine or masculine. We'll now make it feminine. As in, me, ho.
It will follow, preceded by an H.
Yeah. Hey, so
what
say,
happened?
Say it again in English.
Mi totera. Like, it's like I'm really nosy and I go through my parents' stuff a lot.
Grandes éxitos en español.
I see. We should get the Berlitz people on the phone. And
so you go through your parents' stuff a lot, and...
Yeah, so I was going through one of my mom's drawers, and I found, like, adoption papers.
Oh, that's nice.
Oh, interesting. And with your name on it, or, I mean,
yeah.
it was you?
It was my name, and it said Gina Alejandra Cruz. And my name right now is Gina Alejandra Gutierrez.
I see.
Oops, I wasn't supposed to say that.
Well, it's all right. No one understood it anyway. Hold on a second. Drew, isn't it weird? You know, there's an age when you want to snoop through your parents' junk.
Yeah.
And then you get older, and it's like my mom says, go in the kitchen, get the napkins out of the lower drawer. And I'm like, no, you get it. I don't want to know what's in it. I might find something that reminds me of something. You know, it's in the kitchen. It's in the lower. No, I'm not going.
Can't find it.
It's not there. Yeah, I go in the kitchen, I stand there, I look at the drawer for a minute, I don't even open, I walk back, I couldn't find it. You will get to an age when you want to see nothing. You'll hold your ears and run out of the house if you walk in and your mom's like on a phone call and she doesn't know you're there or something, you'll start yelling.
Just singing.
There was a point when you would listen in, when you would want to know, when you would go through your parents' closet when they went out of town and all that, and then you get older and it's like you don't even want to know. You don't even want to come close to knowing. Squeaks.
Mm-hmm.
So squeaks.
Find a big vibrator and a ski mask and a half drunk bottle of Everclear. Squeaks.
So maybe you were adopted. And anything else happened to you funny growing up?
No. See, the thing is, my parents, well, they haven't like told me, and I've like asked them, and they like won't tell me I'm adopted. Yeah. They don't want to.
What about? Who cares if you're adopted? But what about the bondage thing?
Yeah. Anybody ever strike you with anything? Never hit you? Never.
Well, when I was, like, little and, like, I do, like, that stuff, I mean, my parents would, like, spank me, like, yeah. like, when I ran away, like, no, not really then. Like, if I'd, like, fight with my sisters or something.
You ran away?
You ran away?
Yeah.
Why'd you run away?
Because a guy convinced me to go with him.
How old were you?
13.
Oh, baby.
Yeah, we got a lot of stuff going on here.
Boy, you figured you'd be a quick read, but you just keep turning those pages.
Yeah.
There's just more and more. Hey, Squeaks?
Yeah.
Yeah, we got to take a little break. Let me just tell you something. I know the Latino culture. Bondage is not one of their strong hands. It just doesn't work out. You know what I'm saying? You know, those bondage queens, that's a white chick thing.
Well, I look like I'm white.
Still not going to work.
Be that as it may, you know, I don't know that we can get any further with this than your boyfriend has said.
Mistress Cruz? No. That is not going to work.
It's Gutierrez.
Yes. I mean, Mistress Dominatrix Gutierrez. No good. No, you need like a good, strong German name. We're going to work on this. We got to take ourselves a little break.
Really?
Yeah, because she's a mess.
No kidding.
She's run away from home. Yeah. She's into bondage. Squeaks, try not to be bound up or beat anyone in the next 4 minutes, all right?
Okay.
We're going to take a quick break, and then we're going to get back. We're going to straighten your life out, all right?
Okay.
How about Jesus Christ? You into him at all?
A little bit.
Yeah. Jesus Christ in heaven! You like the part about him being nailed to the cross? You wish you were there with a cat of nine tails to really delve out some punishment?
No.
Pussy Romans. I'll show you how to punish someone. All right, we'll be back. Hey, kiddies. It is Loveline. I'm Adam Carolla. It's Dr. Drew over there. Tracy Lords coming in here a little bit later on this week. So we'll talk to her. I don't think I've ever spoken to her on the air. And I think I may have met her once or twice, although... I have spilled a few gallons of seed to her image.
Oh, you really?
Whatever. Yes,
I must admit that.
A few gallons, wow.
A few gallons. Well, that's not a lot. I mean, that's just a couple days.
How did Minka figure into that sort of volume measurement?
Minka?
Yeah.
Minka, you ever see Lake Mead from a helicopter?
Yeah.
That's how much semen
I've
spilled over Minka.
Who is number one?
I'm number one Asian big boob queen. Yeah.
Number one.
She didn't disappoint.
Number one.
She didn't
Asian
disappoint.
Big boob queen.
Minka talks like someone broke a spoon off in her mouth. I am number one. And I kept saying number three, Asian big boob queen.
She argued with you, not number one.
Yeah.
She got upset every time.
No, wait. Dynamite lady. Dynamite. All right. You ready to rock here back with the Squeaks?
Yeah. All right,
Squeaks' deal is she's 15. She's a Latina. And she's a dominatrix, right? She's into bondage.
Mm-hmm.
Do you want
not a dominatrix?
Yes. Yeah. Do you want to delve out the punishment, or do you want to be punished?
Punished.
You want to be punished.
Yeah.
All right. And you ran away with some guy when you were like 13.
And people did hit you when you were bad.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Which is where this all comes from. It's that, again, that repetition compulsion of traumas and arousing, highly arousing traumatic experiences.
You say your dad's a great guy?
Yeah. Well, he never hit me. It was my mom that did.
I see. He mom. Just handed her the ping pong paddle?
No.
What does he do for a living?
He's a railroad engineer.
Really? I didn't know that was a real job anymore. All right. Does he drink a little bit?
A little bit.
Yeah. Yeah, I do too. All right, hey, Squeaks.
Yeah.
This is no life for you, getting beaten on.
Yeah, but it's not going to change unless you really wear this some work. Right?
Can't you feel good about yourself just all of a sudden?
God.
Well, why not? It's the new year.
All right.
How about your resolution is not to get your ass whipped by any guys?
How about little Alatine?
Were you ever raped?
Yeah.
No. Well, my mom said I was, but I don't...
Yeah, my mom tried to tell me I was, too. I didn't listen to her.
Well, no, because the guy... Well, she said it was statutory rape.
Statutory rape.
Some guy had sex with you when you were 9.
How old was he?
Like, 19.
And you were?
13.
Yeah. That's what your mom means. All right, baby. Listen, can you stay home? Or when you leave the house, leave your vagina at home?
Go,
there's no trouble.
Check out a little Alatine. Maybe that's a move in the healthy direction.
Are you doing drugs?
I smoke pot sometimes.
Yeah.
Do you
drink?
No.
Yeah. I'm going to get
just for a laugh.
Get
back on the weed myself. Yeah, I want to see
after this weekend.
What sometimes is with the weed.
All right.
How many days a week with the pot?
Like once a day.
Yeah.
All right.
Okay.
So you're smoking
sometimes.
A lot of weed.
Yeah.
All right, baby. Why don't you get off the weed and get out of the handcuffs and find Jesus Christ?
Well, I don't really believe in him.
I know, but
I sort of do.
Yeah, you sort of do.
Well, I think that's just like any religion that has anything to do with him is basically sexist, and I just don't really approve of it.
Isn't that interesting?
Sexist?
Yeah, well, if you think about it, God is a male, Jesus Christ is a male, all these prophets were guys, and
why don't you check out a little maybe MA, Marijuana Anonymous, and you can go ahead and conceive of your higher power as a female.
Yeah.
And that'd be great.
That's right. Yes, all you women, you're the queens. Now get in the kitchen. Genevieve?
Send those letters to Adam Carolla.
Geneva?
Yeah.
Geneva?
Yeah.
What's up? You're 14.
Yeah, I was wondering, a couple of days ago, me and this other guy, we were having sex and the rubber broke inside.
14. There we go. Yep.
And I was wondering, can that give you, like, any kind of, like, diseases or anything? Because, like,
If he had one.
Oh,
if he has one to give you, that's how you get him.
Well, I don't know if he does or if he doesn't. But,
And one of those diseases, the ultimate sexually transmitted disease, would be pregnancy.
I'm pretty sure I won't have that.
Why?
Hold on. You think that there's some sort of chemical reaction, that transpires when the condom breaks that unlocks some HIV virus that is tucked away in the man's semen that wouldn't be realized otherwise?
No, it's just, because, like, this is my first time, and I don't know.
Yeah. So, what makes you believe you won't get pregnant?
Oh, because I, went and had the shot.
Depo Provera.
Yeah.
Before you had sex.
Yeah.
Okay.
All right. And who's the guy? Do you know him well?
Yeah.
There's a new shot out there, by the way, with estrogen. An estrogen depo shot.
Now with estrogen.
Yeah, which may prevent some of those side effects, that, like the lack of libido and stuff that people hate.
Geneva?
Yeah.
Is this guy your boyfriend?
Oh, yeah, we used to be engaged.
At 14?
Yeah.
Used to be. It must have been they were 13.
Boy, I'll tell you, how much hillbilly do you have to be to get engaged at 13 years old?
Well, because his cousin is, she's already married. She's 15 and she has a 3-month-old baby.
I know. But listen, let me explain something about all you white trashers out there in the world, okay? Don't you realize that you're doing what you're doing? Do you know what I'm saying? I mean, isn't it sort of comical to you to be engaged, to be you?
Oh,
I mean, don't you got to laugh at yourself at some point, being engaged at 13, dating a guy whose cousin's married at 15? You know, all those jokes that people make, they're talking about you. When people are making fun of Jerry Springer and the idiots that are on that show, they're talking about your kin. They're talking about your brethren. Doesn't that disturb you at some point?
If you think about it, it does.
Don't think about it. I mean, don't you not want to be that way?
Well, I don't really find it. I don't care what people think.
I know.
It's not about other people. It's about you.
Care what people think.
A. But B, how about what you think?
I don't really find it. My mom probably would, but...
No, but here's what I'm saying. And I'm not just saying this to you. I don't want to burst your bubble. But I'm saying this to everybody. When you turn on the TV and you see a couple of 400-pound chicks that are missing teeth going at it with a folding chair on Jerry Springer, do you want to be that? Or do you want to be one of those lady attorneys on Ally McBeal? You know, I mean, don't you at least aspire to be the other thing? Do you know what I mean?
Yeah.
I mean, don't you have any fantasies about life?
I used to, but...
You're 14, though. I mean, don't you want to be...
You used to, when you were 8?
No, a couple years ago.
But, I spent a lot of time thinking and reading, though, this vacation, and I realized the thing you and I fight the most... Think about this.
I spent a lot of time drinking and heaving.
I know you did. We've heard about it. But the thing we fight the most is denial. And that's the fundamental thing we're trying to crack through. It's why we have to bet, because we're trying to break through people's denial.
I bet to make money and to fuel my drinking habit.
But you know what I mean? That's what we're up against all the time here on this show.
Yeah. Hey, Geneva?
Yeah.
Listen, I'm not going to BS you and tell you you can be president. But you could be a school teacher and not pregnant at 19. Then why not shoot for that goal?
Well, I don't know. It's just, I guess, because, everybody's been telling me, you can do this, you can do that. I just got sick and tired of it.
All right, well, listen, here, I'm going to be more realistic. You ain't going to be a lawyer, you're not going to be a doctor, you're not going to be a judge, you're not going to be in the Supreme Court, you're not going to be an astronaut, you're not going to be the president. But there's still some other gigs out there that are pretty decent. You can still have a good life. How about it?
Yeah.
You know? The first key is don't get knocked up at 15. All right?
Okay, Mr.
Right.
Drew?
Find Jesus Christ.
Yes.
I don't believe in Jesus Christ.
No.
Yes, Geneva.
I was watching Dateline a few minutes ago.
Oh, yeah.
And I saw your special on there.
Oh, yeah.
I
was on a Dateline thing that finally aired.
Drew was on... what was he doing on Dateline? Because I watched that show.
Team sex?
Drew was teaming some other... some chick with some other dude?
Yeah, he was talking about team sex.
How'd it come off?
Pretty good.
Okay.
I didn't watch all of it. I kind of got bored.
Well, sure.
I have a way of doing that.
Drew was on screen for almost 14 seconds, so I could see you getting tired around the 12-second mark.
That's nice.
All right, listen, don't get pregnant, would you?
I'll try not.
And remember, you can be anything you want to be as long as it pays less than 40 grand a year. Okay?
Okay.
All right.
How do we, I don't know. I spend way too much time thinking and caring.
I come from a downtrodden family.
Think of the denial.
And I know what it's like to throw in the towel at 15. When your parents are using food stamps and talking about saving up, you want to get a sleeping bag, just paste a few more blue chip stamp books and we'll go cash it in. When you come from a lot of that, that's the way you think. I mean, you don't think about being a doctor, being a lawyer. You just don't.
Yeah.
So there's a lot of people out there who come from that environment who don't think about getting out of that environment, and they do just like what a tribe does.
And yet, though...
They become their own tribe.
I understand. And yet, though, the culture they live in with the TV at them all the time, they can have it all. That's got to play in some way in this too.
Yes, but they just become spectators. They just sit outside and
is it that
watch
or
Jennifer Lopez videos,
or is it become I have to have it all or forget it?
Well, it's I want it all, but I'm going to get it all by hitting the lottery, or it'll be nothing.
Yeah.
So I'll work at the slaughterhouse and pick up some lottery tickets every day on the way home. But there's no correlation between work and having it all.
Mm-hmm.
Do you see what I'm saying?
Right.
And nobody who's in their environment has made that bridge for them.
Taught them how to get more.
Right, because their mom or dad sits around, watches the TV, sees the, quote, people that have it all, and says, oh, his daddy left him some money, or he lucked into this, or he hit the lottery somehow. But they never equate it with work, diligence, responsibility, hard work, and all those other good attributes. You know what I'm saying? All right, there's a real mentality amongst the downtrodden to look at people who are successful and make excuses as to why they became successful.
Well, it's
the same thing guys do when they talk about other guys who get a lot of ass.
Yeah.
Look at him, Mr. Sports Car. You know, he's feeding her the Coke. You know, that BS king over there, he's this, he's that, he's the other.
Well, it's envy. Envy's an awful emotion.
Right. So you don't go, he's getting a lot of tail because he's smarter and better looking than I am. You go, he's getting a lot of tail because he, fill in the blank, feeds him the Coke, daddy left him some money, has a BS rap.
Yeah.
And they do the same thing with successful people.
Yeah.
And they're not going to go that route, so forget it. All right, Drew, when were you on Dateline?
I guess just a few minutes ago.
And how come I wasn't alerted to this? I like that show. No? And what was it, a segment on teen pregnancy?
You know, I did it so long ago. I did it like during the summer. Early in the summer.
And was it just one segment of the hour show? You don't know anything,
don't
do
know,
you?
No.
And you'll never see it.
No.
And you don't have it on tape.
No.
And nobody cares.
No.
I don't know.
All right, you kill yourself during the break. I'm going to finish the rest of the show.
Oh, if you were on Dateline, you'd be interested?
If I was?
Yeah. Oh, but we talk about it all night here, I guess.
Then, I would?
God knows they talk about it in the morning show.
All right, we'll take ourselves a little break. When we come back, we're going to talk to Todd. Todd is 33. He's got a fetish with women's panties. Takes them from laundromats and jerks off in them. We'll be back after this. Right. We are going to hop back onto the phones, and we'll speak to young Todd. Todd's not so young. Actually, he's 33, and he's stealing underpants from laundromats and taking them and soiling them in a very unique way. Todd,
you there?
Caller goes by the name of Todd, who soils underpants.
Either asleep or lost him.
Yeah. Let me tell you something, Drew. I never got into any of that weird stuff.
Thank goodness.
And underpants and all that, high heels and dressing up and sniffing shoes. And that's just, I don't know what that is. That's a weird thing to me. Like, to me, I'm there for the event. Do you know what I mean?
So are they.
Yeah, but I'm not there to sniff panties and look at shoes.
Yeah, but that's how
I either get a BJ or forget it.
You just want, well, you're there for the release, right? But that's how these guys get that.
Yeah, I know, but what's up with that? You know, these guys that are, like, stealing shoes and going through panty drawers.
Well, as you've often said, it doesn't usually exist in a vacuum, that kind of thing.
It's a whole weird lifestyle.
There's a whole picture, whole
yeah
thing that goes with that.
Brian?
Brian?
Yeah.
You're 15. What's up?
Okay. I seem to be attracted to girls that are 6 or 7 years younger than me.
And you're how old? You're how old?
15. Drew, trying to...
You stepped on him that time.
Yeah, telling you not to step on him. Drew, just say he's 15. You know he's 15.
15. Okay.
So you like girls that are 9?
Yeah,
that's no problem. I mean, there's plenty of 36-year-old guys who want to date a 30-year-old woman.
Okay.
Same difference.
No, wait, whoa, blah, 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 blah. Now, did something happen to you when you were 9 or 8, 10?
No, nothing like that.
Is this, do you have some sort of, any sense of longing to get back to your childhood for some reason? Or?
I don't think so, nothing like that.
Do you act on these impulses?
I don't.
All right, you know better than to do that.
Yeah.
You can contain that, yes?
Yeah, I want to, but...
What do you mean when you say attracted to a 9-year-old girl?
I imagine them, like...
Uh-oh.
I imagine them doing stuff to me.
And that makes you sexually aroused?
Yes.
This guy is sick.
And you're going to be able to contain those impulses?
Yes.
You understand that those are not things you're possibly going to do?
No, I won't do anything like that.
Boy, that is, that's not the greatest thought.
No.
Hey, you sure you don't want to think about, like, just effing your own mom or something like that?
No, that's disgusting.
I see. I'd rather you think about effing your mom, tell you the truth. Wouldn't you, Drew, as a parent?
Yeah.
No. Drew's a doctor, and he suggests you fantasize about effing your mom.
No, I didn't say that.
Well, that's what I heard.
Yeah.
And the rest of us heard it, too.
Yeah. Yeah. Mommy?
Now, let's get somebody to write some letters about that.
Brian?
Yeah.
So, where does this come from?
That's what I'm trying to figure out.
You have any younger sisters?
I do.
How old are they?
12.
Okay, you gotta kill yourself, okay?
They're two of them that are 12?
No, one.
One?
How old's the other one?
I don't have another one.
They're 12?
Yeah.
Okay. I got 12. Younger sisters?
Yeah.
They're 12? Okay. Well, I guess he kind of committed to the plural when he said sisters. Yeah. So I had to keep it going. All right, so Brian?
Yeah.
And do you have any feelings? I don't mean about her sexually, but I mean, I don't know, when she came onto the scene, you were 3 years old, was she getting a lot of attention? Did she have an illness?
Yeah, a lot of attention. A lot of attention at that point.
When she was born?
Yeah, and still.
And still?
Yeah.
And did she ever have any kind of disability or problem or illness or anything? Yeah. Just a lot of attention.
Yeah.
Interesting. See?
What's your feeling about that? What are you going?
My vibe... I'm just killing time, really, then we can go home. Is it 12 yet? My vibe is... See, you know what guys do? Most guys, but especially like teenage guys, they like... They will sexualize...
Yeah, a lot of things.
A lot of stuff turns sexual.
I'll give you that.
And things that... anger them sometimes
aggression.
Will turn. Now, what I mean is if there's some neighbor that's a pain in the ass and shutting them down or abusing them or whatever, if it's a girl, they'll think about screwing her.
Yeah, yeah.
It's the way things get converted. It's like there's some boss that's running a guy around the office and busting his balls every minute and criticizing him. The guy's fantasy is to have her bent over the desk and really give her a good working. It's kind of like stabbing someone with your penis. At least that's the way I look at sex.
I know. Yeah, I understand.
You see?
Yeah.
So he was three. He was the belle of the ball, the apple of everyone's eye. And then all of a sudden, this infant comes in, and they start showering all the attention on this young girl.
I understand. So he still converted that aggression into focusing on younger girls.
I'm going with
it. In theory, we don't hear that very much, do we, though?
No, this is the Adam theory.
Yeah, exactly.
I've worked this out.
All right. Well,
yeah, I'm with it though. I think it's pretty good.
If he remains preoccupied with that age or younger, he's got to like seek some help.
Yes. All right, Jesse.
Yeah.
What's up?
Okay, I'm 15 to start off, and hey. I'm like totally afraid to have sex.
What's going on in the background there? The bingo game? What is that?
Dateline.
Oh, really?
Yeah, and I got to give you props on that.
Is Drew on now?
No, he was on like half an hour ago.
How was he?
He was good. I got to give him props for that. Because, I mean, I would never be able to, I don't know.
You'd never be able to give advice to teenagers?
Probably not.
I see.
I mean, I give advice to all my friends, but I mean...
You don't think you'd be able to do it, like, let's say, in front of cameras for a living?
No.
Well, what's career option number two?
For me?
Yeah. You cannot be a media doctor. What are you going to do now?
And no, I want to go to college and major in creative writing and be a writer.
I see. Nice. You don't need to go to college for that.
Well, I don't know, just to like get proper English because I'm not good in English.
Hey, Jesse.
Not bad for 15 compared to our usual call.
Let me give you a command in English.
Mm-hmm.
Shut that goddamn TV off.
Okay.
Thank you. Thank you. All right. So someone else saw Dr. Drew on Dateline.
Yeah, I was listening to that. I almost started laughing about it.
All right, so what's your question?
I am, like, totally afraid to have sex.
Good girl.
But, no, yeah, I mean, because, I mean, I know I want to.
No,
it's
you
fine.
Don't.
No, you're afraid. Good.
Good.
What'd your parents do to instill that healthy impulse in you?
I'll get, like...
Taking notes right now.
I'll get, like, down there, you know, with them, and then I'll just be like, I'll just, like, back up and be all, like, scared and stuff.
Wait, by down that, you mean you're about to engage in oral sex with him or what?
No, I mean, just, like, straight up.
Now you're 15. This is a protective impulse. This is. Listen, I did another radio show over the weekend. We were talking about early onset puberty.
Hold on, what radio show are you doing over the weekend?
An NPR thing on Friday. But
really?
Yeah. But listen,
I did that once. There's a lot of angry lesbians over there. They really attacked me.
Well, listen, we did a panel where we were discussing the causes of early puberty. Apparently, puberty's come out like at 8 now in women and girls.
I was having this discussion with my buddy the Wheeze today.
Oh, that. That's a discussion I would love to be involved with. You and Wheeze talking about puberty and 8-year-olds.
As we were going by the taxidermy shop in Burbank looking for an animal head to put up in my house.
Okay. All right.
We had a question about puberty.
Right. We'll come back to this.
All right, we got to get in. All right.
Jesse, we'll be back with you in a second.
All right, and we'll talk about why puberty is setting in at 8 after this. Yep, it is Loveline. I'm Adam Carolla. That is Dr. Drew over there. Phone number.
You were kind of taking the position there.
Taking a gas position.
Thought we were having a welcome back.
Welcome back anus.
Ew.
Welcome back farter.
Yeah, exactly.
Did you see that sitcom from the
70s? Oh, yeah.
Welcome back. Anderson hates that fart talk. I love it. I don't know if I've farted much in the new year. One of my resolutions was to double down on the farting. In the new year, I was trying to think of a New Year's resolution.
Yeah.
Earlier today.
Yeah.
And I thought, let's not bite off more than we can chew.
Yeah.
The Carollas aren't famous for challenges. I thought, let's not do anything and disappoint ourselves by not being able to do it.
Right.
You know, by falling off the wagon sometime in March.
So.
So what I do each year is I try to come up with sort of vague in general, very vague, very...
I'm going to be a better person?
Yeah, stuff like that.
Having me days?
Stuff, well, I do take too many me days as it is.
True.
So
most days a me day with you, I suppose.
You know what my thing was? Drink more water. First off, it's great because it cannot be measured.
Yes.
There's nobody can accuse me of drinking less water. Yeah. You know, 96 was a good water year for me, for you. 89 was what we call a drought for you.
So you cannot disappoint.
No, I can't disappoint myself. Yeah. And it's sort of a general thing. I don't have too much pressure. I'm going to try to drink
a little more
water.
Good joy.
And get to the bottom of why I heave in the morning now and not at night anymore.
Now, we were going to talk about early onset puberty, right?
Yeah.
Oh, yeah, yeah. So it turns out that in this country, in Western countries, the age of onset of puberty is going down to 8.
No, it is not.
8. However, here's what the press... Remember that I was quoted in Time magazine about this and stuff?
Yes.
Yeah. Here's what Time magazine totally missed, and I thought this was genius when I got this all clarified. The age at which puberty... Excuse me. The age at which periods are starting has not changed in the last 50 years.
It hasn't.
So it's the early onset features, which is breast development and pubic hair, that has suddenly dropped down, which is actually not generated by sex hormones. It's generated from the adrenal glands.
Right.
So it has nothing to do with your gonads.
I see.
So it's not about sexuality. It may even be about adrenal function and weight excess, obesity.
Is this for women?
Yes.
And for men, or just for women?
Both, but predominantly women.
I see. So what you're saying is the sexual characteristics are beginning, the breasts and the pubic hair and the lip gloss and the high heels, but not the actual physiological ability to have children.
The menarche hasn't changed.
I see.
It's changed over 500 years, but it hasn't changed recently.
I see. And what do they attribute
that
to?
Remember all the talk in Time magazine about, it's estrogens in the hormone, in the milk and stuff? And
yeah,
the beef.
Hormones in the beef, right.
Guess what? Has nothing to do with those hormones.
What does it have to do with?
With excess body fat, obesity.
Yes.
Which we got a rash of. And
so
I don't know if you watched The Rose Parade last weekend, but you got a little look at what's going on with young people that way.
Well, hold on a second. You get a little obesity, and you're going to get pubic hair at an earlier
you're
age?
Begin converting, yes.
Why?
The conversion of those adrenal hormones by the adipose tissue to hormones that will cause...
Yeah, there's a lot of fat kids.
Yeah.
It's a little too much Nintendo and not enough... we used to play a game called Ditch.
Yeah.
You want to burn some calories?
Yeah.
That's how you...
Or break a leg, too.
Play Ditch.
Right.
we would go into an abandoned junior high schoolyard, some place that was about 30 acres.
Yeah.
And it'd be like, all right, Ray, you're it. The other five of you have
hide
a minute
somewhere
to run.
Yeah.
And you just start running.
Yeah.
And on foot, the guy who was looking for you would just run through the school.
And there was a safe place that they could run back to.
Right.
Right.
And he would spot you like a quarter mile away and just start chasing you.
Yeah.
And the guys would just start chasing you for miles,
yep,
running through the halls, the corridors, get up on the roof, running across the roof, you know.
Yep.
Now everyone sits home and tries to be a Lord Dungeon Keeper and things like that. Mm. Their brains are strong, but the bodies are weak.
Yeah, and so it's interesting, but why do we bring this up?
I don't know.
To Jesse about something.
All right, well, let's just keep going. Clearly, you and I are a little off our game. We got to get back into this job.
We're in the radio?
We've been off for a week. Yeah. Jesse?
Yeah?
So you're 15, and you're afraid of having sex.
Mm-hmm.
And that's good.
Fine. Well, I mean,
you got a boyfriend?
No, I think I was thinking about it. I think maybe it's because I've never had like a actual relationship with a guy.
No. I know why I brought up the early puberty thing. It is because I was going to make the comment that our brains do not develop as fast as our bodies do. And your brain development, in terms of your capacity to emotionally and cognitively handle a relationship and handle sexuality, really doesn't come into full maturity until about the age of 19. And what this one of these guys points these guys made that I was on the radio with, which is what I was going to say,
mm-hmm,
is that really the natural state of the human being is more akin to, say, like a way a ballet dancer lives. Restricted diet, very physical. And in that population, you see the puberty, the menarche, the menses begin around 19.
Right. Yeah.
And that, in fact, in nature, we would be sort of restricted on our calories. We'd be extremely physically active. And in that situation, our periods wouldn't begin until much, much, much later.
All right. I mean, not a ballet dancer, but just some guy living in a wood hut,
exactly,
having to chase prey around and living in some nomadic tribe.
Exactly. Precisely.
All right. Not
so, Jesse, trust your instincts, please. Please understand there's some protective stuff going on.
You're getting pretty heady here, Drew.
Yeah, I see.
All I'm saying is there's going to be trouble, because we were driving through the lovely city of Burbank today, me and the Wheeze, and what started this conversation is there was a couple of teenage chicks walking down the street who could not have been older than 12 and who were built like brick ass houses.
Yeah.
The Wheeze wanted to turn the corner. I said, keep going. Keep going, brother. Put the flask away. He's got this move where he puts a Rolo on his penis and sticks it out of the car window. Tries to get him to come closer.
Very nice.
You know, once you get him into the car, it's a done deal.
Remember that experience with the prostitutes in New York?
Let me tell you how stupid Drew is. And some people like to call it sheltered or naive. I prefer stupid because it's more insulting.
That was lame. How about lame?
Lame is good. Because you can be smart and lame.
I am lame.
Yeah.
This was a great example of that.
When Drew and I were in New York, and we were broadcasting from Westwood One in Manhattan, because of the time difference, we were broadcasting from 1 a.m. to 3 a.m. New York time. And the hotel was close to the studio, and like everyone else in Manhattan, you just walk everywhere. And I think it was after the radio show, and it was about 3:15 in the evening on a weeknight. In the morning on a weeknight. And Drew and I were crossing the street.
It was Broadway, right?
Yep.
Yeah.
It was Broadway, and it was freezing cold, and we're heading back to the hotel. And there was a minivan filled with six black chicks. It looked like Eartha Kitt, basically. Had false eyelashes on the false eyelashes to give them an extra 3/4 inch extension. You know, feather boas, and I mean, they really look like males in drag.
Not that bad.
They really did. They're really out of control. They looked a lot like, if anyone saw the movie Tommy, they looked like what Tina Turner looked like as the Gypsy Acid Queen. And they're in a minivan, and they yelled at us as we were crossing the street, hey, boys, come on.
No, it was like, help, we need to, it was some
no,
sort of
No, it wasn't
help, thing.
Help. No, see, no. That's what makes you a retard. Because hey, sailor gets translated into help, I've ruptured a kidney. Well, do you see what I'm saying?
There was some distress.
No, there was not distress.
Yeah.
It was, hey, boys, over here.
No.
Yes. No, listen to me. How dare you question
my
memory?
Tell the story as you please.
It was not hey, sailor, want a date? But it wasn't, I'm injured. It was to get our attention and get us over to the van. It was, hey, boys, oh, you know, over here, or come here, or something to that. Now, you heard, because if you have low self-esteem, help me. But that wasn't what they were saying. They were saying, come here. And Drew just immediately peeled off from the intersection and started heading for the van. And I grabbed Drew's arm and said, keep walking, Drew. And he's like, those young ladies are in need of assistance. I said, those are 40-year-old coke whores. Do you understand? You're going to get rolled if you go to that van.
And I was like, oh.
And Drew was like, huh? And I said, just listen, keep walking. I'll explain as we walk.
Oh, man, did I feel like an idiot.
True, you were like...
I'm seriously... Now, let me just...
Yes.
In my own defense, I heard like some sort of like distress thing going on. So
That does not defend you. It makes you more psychotic.
Makes you more lame. Absolutely, yeah.
I will go to someone's aid just as fast as anybody else, and I heard no distress from them. I heard, come here. And why would it be distress? It was a bunch of whores in a minivan.
No, I know.
Well, back to the point.
Your mind converted it. Giovanni?
Yes.
You're 27?
Yes.
You're still a virgin?
Yes.
What's up with you?
I don't know. And believe it or not, I'm a GQ fashion model. I've been in every GQ magazine for the last 5 years.
You're gay.
You've jacked off on all of them?
Come on, man.
You've been in them, really?
Yes.
What do you model?
Huh?
What do you model?
Suits, various types of clothing.
Very what?
Anything they ask me to do.
You do clothing. So you make your living as a model.
Yes.
And where do you live now? Where are you calling from?
Right now I'm calling from Orange County.
I have a
condo down here.
I see. And that's all you do for a living as model.
Yes.
So women find you attractive.
Very much so, yes.
What are you doing now? Are you assembling a swing set in your backyard as you talk to us? What the hell is going on?
That's right.
Yeah?
Yeah. My next door neighbor, in a monsoon? Huh?
In a monsoon?
No, my next door neighbor's trash was rolling down the street, and I was attempting to collect it.
All right. Please, sit down and relax, would you?
All right.
Do not recycle while you're talking to us. Thank you.
Where in Orange County are you? Smoke a little cigarette or weed or something.
What was that?
What is that? You smoke a lot of cigarettes?
No.
Weed?
No, I've had a cold.
All right, I believe you.
Yeah,
no virgin smokes cigarettes.
Right.
They don't allow you to smoke. They smell your penis before you buy your first pack of cigarettes.
You hear that? He's
got a cold.
Do you have asthma?
No, I've just had a cold. I just came back from Italy about 2 weeks ago, and I caught a cold with the climate change.
Where do you live in Orange County?
Laguna Beach.
All right. That's Drew's old stomping ground.
Yep.
Is it really?
Yep.
Yeah. And here's the irony.
Rock Pile?
What?
You ever surf Rock Pile?
No, I used to go more south of there.
Oh, okay.
All right. You guys done with your date?
I used to do a lot of lifeguarding in that area. So anyway, so...
Drew was never a model, yet got tons and tons of tail because he's a very passionate man. Ironically, Giovanni's a model and gets no ass. Now, you don't try, obviously.
Or you avoid.
What do you do? As a model who has been in GQ magazine numerous times, women must approach you.
They do.
They do. And are you not attracted to them, or are you scared of them?
I guess I can say I'm scared.
And do you think you may be gay?
No, not at all.
Why not?
Because I'm not attracted to my own sex.
You're not?
No.
And you ever masturbate while looking in the mirror?
No.
Well, you gotta try that.
What was that?
I tried that once. Nice, good time. It looks like the semen's coming at you.
Oh,
that's the thing.
You
jump out of the way. It's great.
You like that 3D effect?
Yes.
Giovanni, so help us. Give us a direction here. What sort of is the issue for you?
I don't know. I guess I had bad experiences with women when I was younger.
Like what happened?
And I don't trust them.
What happened?
Just been played before.
Yeah.
Rebound, sort of.
No.
So is every guy.
So is everybody. And by the way, bad experiences with women makes you want to hump more women.
Right.
That's the way, in a heterosexual male's mind, that's what that translates. That's how that translates. Like, women go through a breakup,
mm-hmm.
and they're like, You know, they're like, I'm not up for it right now. I got to take. Guys are like, I'm going out raping. This is great. Come on. Let's go.
Yeah.
Get that, some roofies and some handcuffs. Let's go out.
Well, my face is all too familiar for that.
I see.
Are you afraid? Too
well known to rape? I see. Yeah. That's my problem.
Are you afraid your career is going to be jeopardized?
No, he's not. There's something up with him. Where's your mother?
Huh?
What's up with your mom?
She's in Los Angeles right now.
Yeah, do you like her?
I think that's where the dysfunction comes.
How many husbands has she had?
Two.
You have some issues with your mom?
Yeah,
what are those issues?
I guess she's tried to control me a little bit. Tried to maybe dominate a little bit.
Yeah. So you're kind of freaked out by women more than you are.
Yeah, you know, I don't want to be controlled or I don't want to be dominated and I don't want to have my life planned out for me.
Yeah, that's bad. How about banging a whore once in a while? What about it?
I'm afraid of disease, man.
I see.
Yeah.
All right, so Giovanni, how about using some of that that model money and putting it toward a little therapy?
How do you think that would help?
Well, first off, it couldn't hurt. Secondly, you're 27 years old. What a waste of penis, by the way. If I was ever in GQ, I would take that, I would Xerox it, I would put it all over the side of my car, and I would drive through town with a bullhorn.
Well, here's the
ladies, come and get it.
Right.
Here's the deal with therapy is it would allow you to have a relationship and to find out what it is that's keeping you from having a real relationship with someone outside of a therapeutic context.
Okay, go to a female therapist.
Yeah.
And have a relationship, hump her if you can.
Yeah.
Is that what you're saying, Drew?
No.
Have sex with the therapist?
No.
Oral?
But to get close, to have a closeness and see what that evokes in you and to work that through.
Go to a female therapist and talk about your mom.
Yeah.
You'll work it out.
Yeah.
You'll be humping in no time.
You ever seen a female therapist, Adam?
Have I?
Yeah.
Have I seen one?
Yeah.
I saw one on TV.
Yeah.
You mean if I actually been to one?
Paid one for a series
sex?
Of sessions. Yeah.
I actually have been. How dare you, first off. And secondly, how dare you?
Yes, answer my question.
I have been in my life to two female therapists.
What was the longest? One was in a group therapy thing, right?
No, one was on own, but also there was some group in there, yes.
Yeah. And, what was the...
what are you talking
no,
about?
No, one was, yes, well, group therapy.
No, you said...
One was in a group therapy.
You said, no, I had seen her individually.
First.
And throughout.
And how long?
There was a group attached
to that.
She's
the one that recommended that you really hang in with therapy longer and you blew out.
Well, they all do.
No.
Listen, they all freak out on you when you leave them.
No.
Yeah.
No.
No, you're right, because I have left a few therapists in my
life. Female therapists.
Well, I faked my own death.
Yeah, female therapist.
Okay, listen here.
Let's go with the show.
First off, jackass, you just earned yourself a fart.
Weak.
That was weak.
See that? Your body's telling you something.
I'm trying to warm up for the new year. My resolution is more gas. Swallow more air and eat more...
Pasta Fazool.
But listen, I had a female therapist for years,
okay?
Jack Hole, and then I had another female therapist, and now I have a male therapist. So I've had three therapists. Two of them have been women, so how dare you?
All right, just checking it out.
Who cares?
Thank you. Aaron?
Yeah.
You're 23. What's up?
Okay. I've had mono twice.
Mm-hmm. What do you mean by that?
This is my second time having
mono. What does that mean, mono?
Mononucleosis.
What does that mean to you?
What does it mean to me?
How do you know that's what you've had?
Okay, I've gone to two different doctors. My gynecologist said I had it once without taking my blood, but she just assumed I had it.
All right, well, so that probably wasn't mono.
Yeah, that was probably AIDS.
It was probably sore throat, virus, something.
Oh, really?
Okay.
Okay, that would explain why I think I have it twice.
Yeah.
and then this time, I actually went to a doctor and got my blood taken.
And you had a positive mono spot test?
It was the Epstein viral, I guess.
No. So you're having chronic fatigue, right?
He didn't say that. He said I had the Epstein viral.
Yeah. But you're not having fevers of 103 and sore throat and can't get out of bed. I mean, that's what mono is. This Epstein-Barr issue.
Yeah, it's nonsense.
It may not be. It's nonsense in many cases. I would not rely on that diagnosis unless an infectious disease doctor gave you that one. But it's controversial, and it all you can say is it sounds like you have something in the order of chronic fatigue. You don't feel good all the time, right?
It's been like 4 months.
Yeah, you have chronic fatigue syndrome. Now, whether or not that's associated with Epstein-Barr is a whole different issue.
Let me tell you what all you jokers have. It's called depression. You're not happy, you don't feel good, and you don't have any energy. And that's the first thing that goes when you're depressed.
This is because Adam had this. And
it's hard to get out of bed when your job sucks.
Yeah, that's true.
All right. But now, magically, if you got a job as a buyer for some big department store chain, you'd pop out of bed. If you got your dream job, what is your dream job?
Acting.
All right. If you got a part in a big budget movie, you and Jim Carrey, you think you'd have trouble getting out of bed?
No, I don't have trouble getting out of bed.
Well, I mean, you have trouble. You think you'd have trouble with the energy?
No, it's weird. I feel like fine, right? But then, like, I can't do the things I used to be able to do. Like, I can't party all night.
All right.
And my glands are all swollen.
Yeah, you've got to. What did you party with? What drugs?
Just alcohol.
I see. Yeah.
Do you have an alcoholic dad or mom?
No.
How's the acting?
I went to college and drank a lot.
How's the acting going?
I'm not really pursuing it.
Why not?
It's just because I think it's just full of BS.
But you're so gifted.
I know, but they couldn't see that.
Yeah.
Well, we'll prove them wrong one day.
Yeah.
Yeah. Whole world will apologize.
Yeah.
This is life that Adam's leading.
Yeah, one day. As the calendar pages blow away. One day. Hey, Aaron.
Uh-huh.
You can't party. Maybe that's a good thing.
Are you taking any medicines at all?
I took, I think it's Valtrex.
Antiviral. Anything else?
No.
Okay. You need to...
I think I took the wrong thing.
Well,
you don't
feel better, do you?
No.
What should she do, Drew?
I would, if you really believe that there's an infectious disease problem, you should see an infectious disease doctor, and you should have a mental health evaluation to make sure that that's not part of the biology of what's going on here, if not the whole story.
What do you do for a living?
It's telemarketing, but it's not outbound.
You're miserable. you're miserable.
I am. It's my job, yeah.
You can't get out of bed.
Right.
Yeah. I know. Listen, I know. I've spent my whole life doing this. Here's the deal. I used to have to get up at 6:15 to go do construction. I couldn't get out of bed. But once in a while, I'd get up at 6:15 to go motorcycle riding. I got out of bed. No problem. No problem at all. What's the difference? One thing I wanted to do, and the other thing I desperately didn't want to do. That is what energy is.
Remember your back pain?
Yes, you have all kind of neck and back problems. But if you think about it, what is energy? If you really just want to break it down. Do you know what I mean?
You mean the enthusiasm to do something.
Energy is a desire to do something or not do something.
Yeah.
You want to do it, you'll do it. You don't want to do it, you're going to have a lot of difficulty in the energy department.
Yeah.
So if you're leading a life where you're doing something, like telemarketing, and you don't want to do it, it ain't going to happen. All right. And like Drew doing this radio show. It's difficulty. See, you can't get it up. We're going to take ourselves a little break. When we come back, we'll speak to Bruce.
Speaking of getting it up.
Bruce can't keep it up.
Yep.
He wants to know how to fix this problem after this.
Loveline will be right back, so get your problems ready.
Yep, it is Loveline. I'm Adam Carolla. He is Dr. Drew over there. Phone number 1-800-LOVE-191.
We lost that caller. We have a different one there. You see that?
Yeah, we had a guy who had a little pee-pee erection problem, and now we have a circumcision problem.
Yeah.
You want to just talk to him?
Sure.
I'm scanning the
It's all similar.
It's all the same Johnson-related questions.
Yeah, stuff that you hate.
That's what I love about this show. I sit here and talk about guys' dorks for 2 hours. It's great, Jeff. And I go home and stare at my own.
Stare? You're getting better.
Yeah. Yeah.
Or more lazy.
Yeah. Mike?
Yeah?
You're 18. What's up?
Yeah, I was wondering, a couple of my friends, they're circumcised, and I'm uncircumcised. My parents didn't have me circumcised when I was born. My brothers are, and they tell me, well, my friends tell me that it's sex is just, like, a lot better if you're circumcised.
Oh, please. They're just BSing.
Wait, why are they telling you that?
Well, I mean, I don't know, because I told them the first time I had sex, I've only had it twice.
Mm-hmm.
But the first time I had sex, it took me an hour and a half, and I didn't even come.
Well, that has nothing to do with your foreskin.
But what? Why are your buddies telling you that sex is better?
I don't know, because, I mean, I talked to them, and their first time, they came in, like, 5 minutes.
Look, think about your loser, dumb friends.
I know, but my loser, dumb friends would want to say whatever it is, whatever condition my penis was in was the worst way of doing it.
That's right.
Be saying it's the better way of doing it.
Huh.
No, his is the worst way is what they're saying.
I thought they're saying...
They're better because they're circumcised.
Is that what they're saying?
Yeah, in a way, because I mean, because I didn't come and I didn't have all these.
Therefore,
it feels better.
Yeah, that's.
I see. All right. Well, then I apologize. I was mistaken, because normally the rap we hear is that it feels better when you're uncircumcised, and that's why I was confusing that, because we never hear it the other way around, do we, Drew?
No, but in fact, it's all such BS. It doesn't matter. It has nothing to do with delayed ejaculation,
Mike,
really, when you get right down to it.
You got what you got. Keep it clean and don't worry about it.
Well, and realize that the ejaculation, delayed ejaculation is either medication or anxiety or just you. Some guys take a while. And as you get to sort of work it out with somebody, if you actually have a relationship, you could, you know, figure out what it is you need to do to shorten that time.
Right. You start dating a certain magazine for a number of months, like I did when I was 18.
And a toothbrush.
And an electric toothbrush. You form a relationship, and then you start to work out some consistency.
It was more of a partnership, wasn't it?
Yeah. I'm really... well, not only was that Frisky magazine my lover, she was my best friend. I really do believe that God works out the amount of time a guy's nuts are good for.
At birth.
At birth, yeah. And that's it.
It's part of the equation.
He's got some kind of clock. And what he does is he sets 90% of guys' clocks at between 15 and 20 minutes. And then he sets...
You think it's that long even? That's right, 12 to...
Right.
We should use right
Drew,
numbers.
Come on,
no,
crap
because guys are going to listen to this and really try to measure themselves.
Okay, but
it.
Here's the deal, Drew. When I say between 15 and 20 minutes, most guys who have sex for 12 minutes say it's between 15 and 20.
Yeah, I know.
But I don't think they're lying. That's what it feels like.
I understand that.
It's like dog years.
I understand that, but that's the point.
My point. I'm giving it a context for them.
All right.
You understand? I'm doing the math
all
for
right,
them.
Right.
Most guys, the average intercourse encounter is probably 12 minutes.
Yeah, that's about right.
Okay. The average male that you interview who has a 12-minute intercourse encounter says 20 minutes.
Yeah.
And I believe he's charitably rounding up.
No.
But I don't think he's lying.
Right.
12 minutes feels like a half hour when you're going at it. It's like you ever jump rope for 5 minutes?
Right.
Feels like you've been jumping rope for half an hour.
It's just 3 minutes in the ring.
Yes. Go box 3 minutes in a ring and see how long 3 minutes really is.
Yeah.
Okay. So now my point is God sets the clock. 90% of the guys, they get 15 minutes. The 5% of the guys, they get 2 minutes.
Yeah.
And 5% of the guys get an hour and a half.
Yeah. Yep.
And that's the way it is.
Yeah.
And that's your clock. And you can practice your yoga, and you can rent your Sting videos, and get in touch with your chi, and you may add 30 seconds or cut 30 seconds, but that's about it.
You know, I had another cocktail party discussion about this tantric sex stuff. And again, it's the greatest thing. I have this friend, she swears by it. And then I questioned more. She swear, what? I've never talked to anybody who actually got something unusual out of this, and I questioned more. Well, she's never. She doesn't have sex.
Yeah.
She ever? I said, did she discover masturbation because of this? Yeah. Well, maybe that's really what's happened.
This is all. It's okay. Right up there with your biorhythms, and all that chi BS and feng shui and all this other nonsense. It's weak-minded people grasping for something in life other than reality. Here's reality. It's you get a hand dealt to you that's going to dictate how tall you are, how strong you are, whether you go bald, whether you get fat, and how long your nuts last when you're having sex. Don't ruin it, but there ain't a lot you can do with it. There you go, everybody. Enjoy. Thank you. Madigan?
Yes, I'm on INH. I was exposed to TB along the line, and I was told to take INH as a preventative therapy.
Yeah. You're 20 years old.
Yep.
What do you do for a living?
I'm a student right now.
How were you exposed? TB, tuberculosis?
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And
he said what's called primary TB. When he takes a skin test, he turns positive.
Yeah.
So somebody who had TB or was in contact with you, so you're positive for TB, but you don't have the symptoms.
Yes.
Is that what that means?
If he were to go on chemotherapy or go on corticosteroids or be re-exposed to TB, then he'd get the real illness. So what you got to do is take 6 months or 4 months of isoniazid or INH to eliminate that remnant primary TB.
So it's... He will not have TB unless his immune system is weakened.
Or is re-exposed.
Or unless he's re-exposed to it. Does everyone take two exposures to TB?
Yeah, essentially.
Really?
Yeah.
Unless
you have some immune problem, yeah.
So it's like the first one sets him up and primes the pump, and then the second one mows him down.
Yep.
Interesting. I didn't know that. Are there other diseases that work that way?
Not really.
I don't hear about that too much. All right, so you get the first exposure, you prove positive to that, you don't have any of the symptoms, they put you on stuff that protect you from the second exposure.
Right, and then you're immune after that, essentially, for the most part.
Good times.
So what's your question?
My question was, I'm having my wisdom teeth out tomorrow, and I'm going under anesthetic for the first time, and I'll be getting Percocet for the first time. I wonder if there'd be any possible interaction.
Well, INH interacts with a lot of stuff, so you really got to talk to your doctor about it. Make sure he understands the interactions.
Okay.
And Percocet is not one of the things you need to particularly be aware of, although are you getting liver tests regularly?
Yes.
Are you taking B6?
Yes.
Okay. So it's the Tylenol and the Percocet is kind of an issue, but you'll be on it in just a couple of days.
Yeah. What's the difference between Percocet and Vicodin?
Percocet's a little stronger.
Really?
Yeah, Percocet's a triplicate. You can't just write a regular prescription for Percocet.
Thanks a lot.
Hey, listen, but one quick question. Adam was kind of going down this path, which is, how did you get exposed?
I think it was probably from pot smokers.
Yeah, I was going to say, the way you get exposed, you got to work in jail, work in a hospital, or be a drug addict. That's how you get exposed.
What did the pot smokers do? Like coughing all over you, or you're sharing a bong?
But they were also, some of them were shooting heroin or something.
No, he didn't know it. A lot of pot smokers cough.
Yeah. No, he didn't know it. They were doing other things that pot, he just wasn't aware of it.
All right.
There you go.
Thanks a lot.
All right there, Manny. Yeah, so Percocet's good, huh? You got to get it in triplicate?
Yeah, it can't get you that one.
Why not? What do you mean triplicate?
It's a very special release to fill out.
Relax.
Hey.
Let
my rule.
Let you do your job. Listen, listen. I'll tell you, if I was a doctor, I'd be much less uptight than you are.
What the hell does that mean?
I'd be giving drugs out to my friends.
Yeah, no doubt.
Candy.
No doubt.
I work it all out. Don't you hear about these guys? What about Elvis's doctor?
Yeah.
He got away with it. You're too uptight, Drew. You give me some of that Percocet. I'm going to try some of that. Jeff?
Yeah.
Jeff, you're 17. What's up?
Yeah. I'm having problems right now with my girlfriend. It feels like she's still seeing her ex-girlfriend. I guess kind of cheating on me.
Her ex-girlfriend?
Yeah, I picked the weird ones.
Yeah, so...
Why does it feel that way to you?
Well, I mean, it's just like... Well, it's obvious. I know her ex-girlfriend, and I've talked to her before, and, it's like we'll plan something to, go out, and I'll give her a call, and she'll be with her ex-girlfriend. It's like...
I see.
And then she doesn't want to talk about it.
Get two chicks in the same bed. Do them.
Oh, nice.
Who was that?
That's Varsity Blues. What's his name? Big guy.
Oh,
Ron.
That was Ron, yeah. Ooh, that's a guy who went down on a hooker.
Yeah.
Hey, Jeff?
Yeah.
Yeah, she's a little chaotic. You know it.
Well, it's just substitute boyfriend, and every guy would go, oh, yeah, I wouldn't tolerate that, alone with her ex-boyfriend. No way. And, you have a reason. It's reasonable that you should not want her to do that, that it'd be hurtful to you, and that she would be respectful of your feelings. So just on that basis alone, I got a problem with it.
How old is she, Jeff?
19.
19?
Yeah.
Score. You're in high school?
Yeah.
Natural bisexual.
Banging away with a 19-year-old bi chick?
Yeah.
Yeah. It's pretty good. She must be a real mess.
Well, I'm not into the whole threesome thing in a relationship.
Yeah, we understand that part.
No, you know, I know, but she must be a handful. You know what this reminds me of? I don't know why. Everything gets translated into cars to me. It's like you're seeing some dude. It's like you meet some dude at the 7-Eleven, and he's wearing a pair of bad jeans and bad shoes and stuff. And you go, what kind of car do you drive? And he goes, 928. And you go, you're driving a Porsche? Uh-huh. And then you close your eyes, and you're picturing the version of that car.
Yeah.
And you're going, well, probably got some miles on it. Yeah. Probably burning a lot of oil. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah, yeah.
So when Jeff goes dating a 19-year-old bi chick, and you go, whoa-hoo, and then you go, wait a minute.
It's not Claudia Schiffer.
Closing my eyes here, and I'm picturing this chick. Jeff?
Yeah.
All right, listen. You're not going to marry her, are you?
No. Well.
Wait a minute, goofball. You gave a long pause before you said no.
Yeah.
Here's how I want you to answer. Watch, Drew. I'll be Jeff. Okay. Ask me if I'm going to marry her.
You going to marry
her? No!
This? Okay.
Wait, let's try it again.
Oh, shoot.
Let's try it again. You ready?
Jeff, you're
going to...
No!
Okay. what a relief.
Are you? And you yell no.
No.
Okay, let's try it again.
Jeff, are you going to... Are you thinking about marrying this chick? Okay, good.
Very good.
But I really like her. And
yeah, I know. You're 17, and you're sucked into something here.
He's in a little over her head. You're going to save her, right?
Well, he's going to fuse
she's
with her.
She's chaotic. Yeah. She's had some trouble in the past. You're going to take her away from all that?
No, that's not my goal. She makes me happy, and I really enjoy spending time with her.
What's she do for a living?
She's going into the Air Force.
She's going to have a good time there. She's going to earn her wings. Those wings are going to be on each side of her face.
Oh, boy.
Yeah.
Well, please, Jeff, just don't get...
It's doomed. It's doomed. I'm sorry. I wish someone would give me a healthy dose of reality when I was 17.
She's behaving in a way that's disrespectful of your feelings, and that's not a good relationship to be in.
Okay, but
listen.
She's going to the Air Force. She's 19. Yeah. She's kicking around with her ex-girl. It's doomed.
Yeah.
Doomed.
It's not good.
This is Hindenburg-type doomed.
Yeah.
Do you hear me? So, here's what you do. Do not get her pregnant. Try to... Not go crazy.
And try to realize what time you do have with her.
There will be other women. Yeah. One day you'll be married to a beautiful woman with beautiful kids, and you'll be thinking to yourself, what the hell was I doing? And thank God. Listen to me, all you who are praying for things. Let me tell you about praying for things. There were times in my life I would have signed a deal with the devil for a $10 an hour job that would have lasted my entire life. Thank God I didn't.
Yeah.
There are times when I would have... signed a deal for the devil to drive a VW bug for the rest of my life if I could just get four wheels under my ass instead of a beat-up motorcycle. Thank God I couldn't sign that deal. There were deals I would have signed with many girlfriends about not leaving me. Thank God I couldn't sign that deal. I would have been driving a VW bus, living with Stephanie Hunt in some dump and making $10 an hour.
You'd be happier.
Actually,
yeah,
right.
Yeah,
why didn't I sign? Why didn't I sign? Here's
but now look
deal.
At you.
Now look at me. Literally a millionaire enjoying life every day. I wake up in the morning. You know what I do? I fling open the curtains and I pound my chest and I yell, Abundanza!
Whatever.
Yeah. That means abundance. I learned it from a frozen pizza commercial in 1974. All right, we're going to take ourselves a little break. Drew, you really believe I do that with the curtains?
No. You don't have curtains, you have four light windows.
Here's the worst.
Be real here.
Here's a better reality. I roll out of bed. I pick up the phone. It's beeping, and I go, oh, Christ, somebody called.
Yeah.
And then I put the phone back down. I go back to bed.
Yeah. Well, you masturbate and go back to bed.
Oh, I didn't say masturbate?
No.
I'm sorry. I meant masturbate. Go back to bed.
Yeah.
Masturbate. Put down the phone. Go back to bed. We'll be back. Yep. It's the love line. All right, let's hop on the phones. Tracy Lord's going to be in here a little bit later this week. She's quite articulate.
Shawnee Smith from Becker tomorrow night?
Oh, yes. All our listeners are into that Becker. Steve?
Yeah.
You're 20?
Yeah.
You pass semen in your urine?
Yeah, I think so.
Yeah.
What do you mean, think so?
That's what it looks like.
Could it just be mucus or discharge?
Huh?
How about when you hawk a loogie? Is that semen coming out of your mouth?
I don't think so.
Could it just be mucus or discharge?
I'm not sure.
Yeah, that's our point. You may have an infection.
Yeah.
The last guy we talked to who was passing semen with his urine was just really passing pus.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Semen is really pus with a little sperm sprinkled in.
And sometimes medication, too, like cold medication, that kind of thing can trigger this.
Yeah. You know how, like, Thousand Island is really just kind of mayonnaise with a little ketchup in it?
Nice.
That's what semen is.
That's nice.
It's pus with a little bit of sperm sprinkled in.
Where's Anderson with that vomit sound? There we go.
Spoke to David Alan Greer tonight, actually.
Oh, yeah? Yeah.
Yes. He left a very long-winded, funny, and semi-insulting message on my answering machine I'd love to play in the air.
What was the bottom line?
He yelled at me for yelling at him on his answering machine.
I see.
How long have you been blind, deaf, and dumb? I can't take it, Adam!
How do we play a message from my answering machine on the air, Anderson? I saved it. We should do that.
Bring it in here, yeah.
How do I bring it in? I can't bring it in. It's message center.
Maybe he can call in right now. And
tomorrow night, if you get here, like, within 10 minutes of the show, we can call it up and I can put it on there.
Yeah, it's asking a lot there, Anderson.
You're saying 10 minutes before the show begins?
Yeah, well, how about like 2 minutes?
I'm not going to commit to it, but all right. Okay, all right. Let's just say hypothetically, yes, we'll be here 2 minutes before the show
begins. Steve, you want any medication at all?
No.
Nothing?
No.
You haven't taken anything over the counter or anything like that?
No.
I mean, there are circumstances where this can happen, but the first order of business is to make sure it isn't an infection.
Have you had sex with anyone weird?
No.
You wearing a condom?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. All right. How about going and getting yourself checked out?
All right.
There you go.
Drew, what about, could he bring in a sample? Could he bring in a sample?
Yeah, pee. Sure.
Yeah, just bring in a little whiz?
Absolutely.
All right. I'll do that. Danny?
Yes.
You're 16.
Yes.
What's up?
Just like last week, my teacher, we've always been kind of close, like, and then, like, out of nowhere, she kissed me after class. Mm. And it's, like, really, I was really bothered by it. And, like, I'm not sure, like, what should I do? Because she's, like, always been, like, a good friend to me.
What kind of kiss?
What?
What kind of kiss?
Yeah, a really deep one. And I just kind of pulled away. I'm like, just walked away.
Working her tongue in there?
Yeah.
Really?
Yeah.
Oh, nice. And is this a private school?
What? No. Tustin High School. Oh, whoops.
Oops.
Oh, well.
You become close with teacher at a public school?
Well, like, not like...
They're the enemy. What are you doing? You shouldn't be talking to them.
No, she's really cool. She's always kind of, she's helped me with my work and everything. I used to be, like, a really bad student. Yeah. She's kind of helped me, but like, you know.
Uh-huh. And you're freaked out by it.
Yeah, it's just like...
What are you freaked out by?
It's my teacher. And, like, it's just really uncomfortable.
All right.
How did this happen? How did this come about?
I don't know. Like, we seem to always have, like, a good relationship, like,
No, I mean, what were you doing the moment this occurred? How did she...
Oh, I was just helping her, like, sort some papers out.
I see.
And what did she say? Come here, I want to kiss you?
No, we were just, like, talking about stuff. We were just... And she just, all of a sudden, just out of the blue, she just kissed me.
I'm afraid either you have to end this relationship.
What relationship?
Well, the friendship. She's crossed a boundary.
Oh, yeah. Okay, if you're freaked out by her, just don't hang with her. She'll get the message.
And...
I know, but she's like... I don't know, should I tell somebody or like...
Nah. I think you should.
No, don't puss out. Oh, please. Tell somebody.
Tell if there's a dean of students or...
What are you, wearing a little sailor suit and licking a giant lollipop? You're 16, you're in high school, for Christ's sake.
If this were a woman, how would we do it?
Some older broad coming on you, fine. She's divorced, she's lonely.
What if this were a woman...
Menopausal hot
being abused by a male.
How old is she?
I think she's like in her 30s, like 32.
I see. Okay, so older woman.
Yeah.
Very old woman. Now, listen, Danny.
Yeah.
Listen, don't get in a position where you're camping with her. Okay, don't go camping with her unless you want to nail her. Just don't, if you're uncomfortable, just when the bell rings, get up and leave with the rest of the students.
Okay.
It'll be over and done with. Don't tell anybody you're fine. All right? It's important to cry and cower in shame every night when you get home, though. Okay?
Yeah, but she may need some redirection. She may be having some problems here in mental health.
She's a little freaked out. She's fine. Well, give me a worst case scenario. She victimizes another guy who she gives a BJ to in her car in the parking lot.
Worst case scenario, she's doing drugs or she's bipolar and really starts to do some weird stuff with kids.
She's fine. Wait till she gets popped. Stay out of there. Enjoy. That's what I say. Stay out of other people's business. Don't get involved. Keep driving. That's what I say. All right, we're going to take a break. We'll be back. Hey? Oh, yeah. Doing the show.
Yeah.
Well, Drew and I were just having a little argument about parents. All righty, then. Now. Oh, is Lit coming back on here again?
January 11th.
Wow. That's funny because I ran into one of those Lit guys at the swap meet. Yeah.
Oh, wow.
Yeah, good story.
Nice guys.
Yeah, yeah. Should I go on about it?
Did you recognize them?
Yeah, I did recognize the Lit guy because he's the guy who has beard. The ponytail beard.
Yeah.
And these are wonderful stories.
Yeah.
Oh, I saw a lot of Huelhauser over the weekend. Nice. Did you see Huelhauser?
Not once.
What is wrong?
And I watched a lot of TV, too.
All right, all right. I've had to wash my hands and my ass with you. Yeah. We will be back tomorrow night to dispense more useless knowledge. So, until next time, this is Adam Carolla for Dr. Drew saying mahalo.
Oh, boy. Now, this is wonderful.
This has been Loveline. The opinions expressed on the show are not necessarily those of the staff, management, sponsors, or this station. The producer for Loveline is Ann Wilkins Engel. Loveline is a presentation of Westwood One Entertainment.